Hello, and welcome to the At His Word broadcast. I'm your host, the Reverend Darrell A. Thompson, Sr., pastor of the Bass Street Missionary Baptist Church. And I want to thank you for joining us, taking time out of your schedule to share with us on today. At the At His Word broadcast, our mission is to encourage the saints of God, to lift them up and reassure them that they serve a God who stands by His Word. For if God makes a promise, He is not a man that He can tell a lie. The Bible declares that God's word shall not go forth from Him and return unto Him void. So my brothers and sisters, no matter what your circumstance, no matter what your situation, problem, pressures, or pains, I want you to be assured of this one thing. You can take God at His word. Come now and join us in our worship.
Time for giving up. This is not the place where you should be. No, it isn't. No, no. Not the time or the place to lie in defeat. You gotta hold on. You gotta press on. Sometimes you win. Sometimes you lose. It's a part of life.
I forgot.
It winds through. Sometimes there's joy. Sometimes there's pain. It's a part of God's plan. So don't be dismayed. This is not the time.
The time
oh yeah. You gotta learn. Gotta learn. Wait on the Lord. This is not the time.
Not the time
oh, yeah. You gotta learn.
Gotta learn.
And this is not the time to question your faith. And this is not your place of destiny. No, it isn't. No, no. It's not the time or the place to throw in the towel. You gotta press on. You gotta move on. Sometimes you win. Sometimes you lose. It's a part of life that everyone goes through. Sometimes there's joy. Sometimes there's pain. It's a part of God's plan. It is His own plan. This is not the time.
Not the time
oh, yeah. You gotta learn, gotta learn. Wait on the Lord. This is not the time.
Not the time
oh, yeah.
You
gotta learn. There's still hope for the hopeless.
There is hope for the hopeless.
There's still life for the lifeless.
There is life for the lifeless.
God is a friend to the friendless.
He's a friend to the friendless.
He'll give you peace and sweet rest.
He'll give peace
and sweet rest. There is hope for the hopeless.
There
and there is a life for the lifeless. God is a friend to the friendless.
He's a friend to the friendless.
He'll give you peace and sweet rest. That time or place that leads in faith.
Judges chapter 3, verse 31, and I'm going to read from the New King James Version. And it reads in this manner: After him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, who killed 600 men of the Philistines with an ox goad. And he also delivered Israel. That's all we need right there. After him was Shamgar, the son of Anath, who killed 600 men of the Philistines with an ox goad, and he also delivered Israel. I want to use for a thought, amen, for the next couple of weeks, I want to talk about the power of one real man. The power of one real man. In 1966, a book was published of an American admiral. And in this book, he was quoted saying, "There are no great men, only great challenges that ordinary men are forced by circumstances to meet." You didn't catch that. The quote goes that there are no great men, only great challenges that ordinary men are forced by circumstances to meet. But as I read that, I couldn't think about the quote by President John F. Kennedy in 1956 in his Profiles of Courage. He writes, "Great crisis produces great men and great deeds of courage." Simply saying, my brothers and sisters, that many of us are not born great, but it's when we face a great adversary, a great obstacle, that greatness is produced within us. Some of us have tendencies to run from great challenges, dodge and hide from great circumstances and issues of the day. But the truth of the matter, my brothers and sisters, is that God is looking for some great men. Now, I don't want you to feel left. Let me just share this with you because I really want to talk to the men today. But women, I want you to understand these principles also apply to you also. Because in each and every last one of us, there lies the potential for greatness. Where do I get this from? According to the word of God, the Bible says that God spoke and said, "We shall create, let us create man in our image." And in other words, literally it suggests, watch this, that God is saying to you and I that, watch this, greatness is in you. Whether you know it or not, whether you agree with it or not, whether you like it or not, greatness has been implanted in each and every last one of us. The thing is not that greatness is not there. It's just that most of us dare not tap into the greatness that has been planted inside of us. My brothers and sisters, and I hope I'm not alone in this statement I'm about to make, but I believe that the potential is possessed by you and I all together and individually. Watch this. There is many of things that God has said that we can accomplish, that we can do, that we can have. But the problem is we allow the devil to present the rebuttal to what God has promised. And instead of listening to God, we listen to what Satan has to say. Watch this. I believe, watch this, that God is not opposed to us being great. Because many people say, well, no, you ain't supposed to be thinking like that. But the devil is a lie. Because God desires for us to be great. He desires for us to think great things. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, watch this, God is opposed to pride, not to greatness. The Bible suggests that God is opposed to pride. But never does he says he's opposed to greatness. And whether you know it or not, there is a big difference. And we don't understand it, so we don't embrace it. We are satisfied with being mediocre, just along the gray line, just traveling along to get along. But God says he desires that we understand greatness is in each and every last one of us. Watch this. In Genesis chapter 18, around that 17th through the 18th verse, there you will find, watch this, that God refers to Abraham as not only a great man, but also a great nation. This is God speaking. In Genesis chapter 12 and around that second verse, God said directly to Abraham, I will bless you and make your name great. 2 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 9. There God leaves on record, and I have been with you wherever you have gone and have cut off all your enemies from before you and have made you a great name, like the name of the great men who are on this earth. And you got to understand, every scripture I just read from you is God speaking to us himself and saying that greatness is for each and every last one of us. And it's sad, my brothers and sisters, when God says you can be great, but you choose not to. God says there's so much of me in you, but you don't want to operate in the me in you because you are afraid of what it might cost you. But this is God himself is speaking and asking and begging of us to remember that he is telling us that greatness is within us. Okay. I can hear somebody, you know, I thank God for this ability to hear, because I can hear somebody right now saying, yeah, that's what God said to Abraham. That's what God said to David. He said that, but he never said that to me. He never spoke that in my life. I never heard God say that I was supposed to be great. Watch this. Allow me to go. Just go with me, if you will, to John chapter 14, around that 12th verse in John chapter 14, around that 12th verse. Jesus himself states, truly, truly, I say unto you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do. In other words, my brothers and sisters, Jesus states plainly that if you believe in him, you are going to do stuff that even he didn't do while he was on the earth. Which sounds like to me, Jesus is speaking into your life and telling you that he is expecting you, he is looking forward, he's encouraging you to do great things for the kingdom of God. Look at your neighbor and say, you're supposed to be great. Now watch this. If Jesus says you will do greater works than he did, then watch this. Evidently, God does not have a problem with greatness. Neither does he have a problem with the recognition of greatness. New Jersey Senator Bill Bradley, in his commencement address at the Middlebury College in 1989, stated that, watch this, an article of the Democratic faith is that greatness lies in each person. I hope you caught that. The very article of the Democratic faith is that greatness lies in each person. And if any one of us has ever walked away from our destiny of greatness, watch what has happened. You literally walk into the traps of Satan. Because the Bible tells us that Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to destroy your desire for greatness. He wants to kill your influence for greatness. He wants to steal your joy that comes from your greatness. I wish I had somebody in here who knew what I was talking about. Satan don't want you great. He wants you to stay mediocre. He wants you to stay at the bottom. He doesn't want you to have everything that God has in place. Because Satan doesn't want us to realize that, watch this, true greatness involves, first of all, analyzing your gifts. He doesn't want you to understand that true greatness causes you to analyze your talents, your skills, and watch this, and capacity in God's name and for his glory. And then what you do is, once you learn what gifts and the skills and the talents you possess, now you begin to maximize them, to use them for the kingdom of God in an effort to expand your impact on everyone else.
In other words, he says that when you learn how great you are, you ought to start impacting other people's lives for the kingdom of God. There's no way you should come to church for the last 30 years and still nobody sees anything in you. God said, how can you look like me and nothing's happening through you? How can you be related to me and you're not walking in the authority that comes and the power that comes with being a child of the King? Because if you are a real child of the King, you understand that when you walk through, the devils in hell have to get out of your way. They have to tremble and run away from you. They dare not mess with you because you understand the authority and the greatness of your Father. And when your Father says something, it causes things to happen. And God says, you have greatness in you. Now, I hope you kept your Bibles open to Judges chapter 3 and around that 33rd verse, because watch this. In our text today, we discover a man, watch this, whose name is not announced or pronounced again after this text. After you hear about him this one time, you won't hear about him anymore. And one of the reasons, watch this, when we look at this text, as a matter of fact, let me just back it up like this. As a matter of fact, there are only 46 words about his whole testimony in the Word of God. But how many of you know that you don't have to live long to live strong? We got some folks that's been around for umpteen and umpteen upon umpteen years and still ain't made a difference nowhere. Baby, it ain't about how long your life is, but the truth of the matter, it's about how strong your life is. Because you can live 20 years and made an impact on this world that we're living in when you recognize that God has given you greatness. This man is not talked about anymore after this verse. And watch this. And it's when we get to this point, watch this, and that is what is coming about here in the life of our host. Now, you got to understand, the man we want to talk about is Mr. Shamgar. In fact, allow me to ask you this question. Who ever heard of his name before now? That's just how much they talked about. But that's just how much he wants to be talked about. He sought not for glory. He sought not to be called and have riches put up on him. He sought not for men to recognize him. Mr. Shamgar, watch this, is just somebody who's seen an issue and had to do something about it. What? Since many of us don't know about Shamgar, allow me to share a little bit of with you. Shamgar, watch this, lived in the time of Judges. Now, when we read our Bibles, I'm sure we do, we would discover, watch this, that Judges was really a time of chaos, followed by peace, followed by chaos, followed by peace, followed by chaos, followed by peace, followed by chaos. Judges was a time when watch this, what would happen is the product, this was literally a product of what we call the sin cycle. Now I know some of you are saying, well, what's the sin cycle, Pastor? Let me just share the sin cycle. What would happen is the Israelites would rebel from God. They would go through tribulations, and when they went through the tribulations, they would repent, and then when they repent, they received restoration, and when they received restoration, they received a period of rest. Then after they received a period of rest, they would go back to the period of rebellion. And then they would go back to the period of tribulation. Then they would go back to repentance. Then they would go back to restoration. Then they would go back to rest. And then they go all the way back and rebel and do what God told them not to do all over again. Don't that sound like somebody we know? We get caught up. We get messed up. We come to God and say, God, I'm sorry. God, I want to start my life over. And then the moment God begins to remove that stuff from you and start to restore you back to where you used to be, then everything begins to go great. Everything feels good. And then the moment everything is going well and we're not stressed out anymore, what we turn around and do, go back and do the very same stuff that got us in trouble the first place. Then we go through the process all. I'm talking about the book of Judges. We get caught. They were caught up in the sin cycle. And literally, watch this, my brothers and sisters. This is what we would call a postmodern era. It's a postmodern era. It's basically this, what? When relativism rules. Someone said, well, Pastor, what is relativism? Watch this. In relativism, there are no absolutes or any guidelines to govern individuals or the society. In fact, if you got your Bibles up, Judges 21 and verse 25 makes it so clear. Judges 21 and verse 25 makes it so clear. He said it like this. He said, every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's a postmodern era. That's the era we struggle in right now, where everybody do what they want to do, and it watch this, as long as it's all right in their mind, as long as they say it's okay, it's okay. That's why we have these alternative ideas, alternative lifestyles, because nobody now today wants to see what God says about it. It only matters what I think about it. And so now we're starting to see the relationship and the comparison of the book of Judges and 2014, because he said everybody was doing everything that was, long as they felt good with it, it was okay. Long as they felt like nobody was being physically hurt, it's okay. But my brothers and sisters, you gotta be careful about your own eyes. So, let's see, watch this. In this time, book of Judges, no one cared about governance or rules. No one cares about how God has set up. Nobody cared then about the Ten Commandments. They looked out for no one but themselves and their own. And this, my brothers and sisters, was a terrifying time to live. Because all we have to do is look at the text in Judges chapter 5 and verse 6. And there we observe, watch that it states again, in the days of Shamgar, the son of Anah, in the days of Jael, watch this, the highways were deserted. And travelers went by roundabout ways. You want to know how bad the times were? My brother, watch this. People were not even traveling the main roads. And if they did travel, watch this. They have to sneak and take the back road. You're talking about times were bad when you had to sneak to go. In fact, it sounds like today when our seniors have to sneak because we got young men and young girls just waiting to rob them, just waiting to take them. This is what was going on. When they had to lock themselves in the house and then lock themselves out of the house. Exactly. That's exactly how we living right now. This was a time of terrorism when groups of men would go around and creating havoc throughout the land and putting everyone in a state of fear. Thuggery dominated the land to such a degree that people had to walk around the outer edges of the city to go where they needed to go. But how many of us can testify that the enemy of God don't last long? Because I believe that God offers us a chance. You got to hear me, my brothers and sisters. God offers us a chance to turn from our wicked ways. God never destroys anyone or any nation without offering them a chance to turn from your wicked ways. Literally, what I'm trying to say is, when you're doing what you feel you're big and bad and old enough to do, God will present you ample opportunity to change, because here it is. God says, either you change yourself or I'll change you. And if you don't change it, you ain't gonna like my change. But these men were going around causing terror and chaos. And out of all this chaos and all this turmoil, watch what God does. God raises up a soldier. Or as I would like to say to you today, one real man. Out of all these men in the country, God found one good real man. And you got to understand something, my brothers and sisters. God is looking for some real men. In fact, he's looking for some real men to reveal to them the power that they possess. Watch this again, Judges 31. I hope you kept your text open. 31, watch this. He says, and after him came Shamgar, the son of Anath, who struck down 600 Philistines with an ox goad. Watch this. And he also saved Israel. Shamgar. Now, to understand the real man that Shamgar is, you got to understand something. First of all, according to our text, Shamgar was not a military man. He hasn't been trained, watch this, in how to tactically attack the enemy. He hasn't been trained how to flank the enemy, come in from the side, send some troops around the back. He had not been trained. He was not a politician. He didn't have no pull. He didn't know folks who knew folks. He didn't have nobody on his side. He was just a man that seen we got a problem. And my brothers and sisters, can I just say something to the men today? You go find out who I real you are when you notice that you got a problem. Either you're going to sit back and do nothing, or you're going to be the real man God created you to be and say, we got to fix the problem. Watch this, watch this. The Bible says that Shamgar carried an ox goad, which suggests to me that he was a farmer. Because watch this, the ox goad was nothing but an 8-foot stick. And on one end of the ox goad, it was an 8-foot stick, it had a sharp point. And what the farmer would do is, as he was plowing the field and the ox would stop, the farmer would take the pointed end and he would stick the backside of the ox to coerce him into going on and pulling harder. But on the other side of the stick was a flat end like a shovel. And what the farmer would do is, it would be covered with iron. And when the ox would run into the throw through the field, he would come across a big rock. What the farmer would do is take the flat end of the stick, dig in under the rock, tip pull the rock up, move it out of the way so that the ox could keep going. And this is what was called an ox goad, just an 8.